Around 1996, I did a research in the Mekong Delta for my PhD. And there was unsustainable development happening everywhere. And to me at that time, the thing that I worried the most was that I saw nature disappear just in front of my eyes. And that beautiful area just getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And I have tried many different ways, try to convince people to protect it, but nobody listened to me. I was not successful. And that's when you came in.
Yeah. As soon as I got down there and as soon as I saw what was going on, I think it's actually the only time I've had a sleepless night just purely due to work. I just think, like, what can I do? How do I do it? And so then through discovering you, I could begin to see how we might be able to do something. It's hard to kind of explain that area because it's not a pristine, beautiful, natural area. There's been a lot of change. It was bombed during the war. But even so, you have these wetlands, you have these incredible birds, the Sarus crane, that actually come and use it seasonally. When do you first remember seeing a Sarus crane, and what impact did it have on you?
The first time I saw a group of crane back in 1986, standing in the wetland, I thought that it's a group of farmers doing work on their field because the crane was very tall. I never seen big bird like that before.
We're talking about the world's tallest flying bird. If you stand next to them, you'd be looking directly into their eyes. They're 6 foot tall. They have these bright red heads and gray bodies. They're incredibly elegant with this huge wingspan as well. I remember hearing them from distance, and it's like nothing else you've heard. It's this almost primeval sound. You know, you think, I could have been standing there in, you know, the dawn of time, and you'd still be hearing, you know, these birds coming over. It's an extraordinary sound. This is the bird that carries your soul to heaven, right? I mean, it plays an incredibly important role in Vietnam. After the war, there was a sense that it had been lost. It was extinct, this population. But it came back from that. We were then worried we were going to lose it because we wouldn't be able to keep any habitat for it in Vietnam, but we've kept some on the map. We really tried to say, look, this is an area where we want to see development, and we want to see the poor have opportunities to live better lives, and we want to see industry prosper, but we also want to see the natural heritage of this area be conserved as well.
You brought the World Bank and you brought IFC to the table. It's substantial enough for the local authority to listen. And I think that the most critical factor, without the involvement of IFC, without the award from the World Bank, I don't think our voice can be heard.
IFC, we were this big global presence, and perhaps we brought people to the table. Mm. But you were the person who had the credibility locally, who knew the area, knew the communities, knew how we should be dealing with government. And we were great dance partners. You know, we came from very different backgrounds.
Oh, it's incredible stroke of luck that our path crossed. It took 14 years for Fumi finally to become recognized as a protected area. So the important lesson that I learned from this story is that for some social and environmental change, it may take a long time before it can happen, real changes.
The other piece of this, which is so important, is it's not just about the crane. We're talking about communities here too. You have a minority Khmer area where you have very poor communities who had been relying on these wetlands for hundreds of years. And how are we going to help them?
Yeah. Fumi is the new model of protected area management in Vietnam, in which we allow people to have access to the resources inside the protected area. For all other protected area, people are excluded.
Yeah, they're sort of
not
pushed out.
Allowed to take anything from a national park or from a nature reserve. But at Fumi, it's a new model.
They're the stewards of the park, aren't they?
Going forward to the future, it may be a way to compromise between development and conservation. We need to find a harmony between the two to move forward.